Like silken thread, love holds us fast. Bonds like this are meant to last. Join the best relationship and marriage talk show, Helpers of Your Joy, weekdays from 9 p.m. to 10 p.m. here on Sweet Melodies 94.3 FM. Join your host and other experienced spirit-filled marriage counselors for sound biblical counsel on relationships and marital issues. Remember, it's 9 to 10 p.m. Monday to Friday here on Sweet Melodies 94.3 FM. Helpers of Your Joy, helping you have a joyful and blessed relationship.
Looking for excellent and stylish accommodation away from home? Errata Hotel is the destination for you. Come experience a wonderful ambience and excellent service. Our facilities include 7 conference rooms with state-of-the-art audiovisual equipment, 72 luxury rooms with free continental breakfast, restaurants with the best local and continental dishes, bar, swimming pool, gymnasium, and business center. Errata Hotel also offers free internet and free airport pickup services. Locate us in the serene environment of Okponglu, East Legon, Accra. For enquiries and booking, call 0544-336761 or 0263-003927. Errata Hotel. We set the true standard.
Said, husbands, love your wives as Christ hath loved the church and gave himself for it. Now there's a real lover. You see, my friend, a good lover is more than hips, lips, and fingertips. It is the ability to hold the cold wind of life in your hot hands until the wind warms under your loving touch. It is standing by the bed until the light goes out in my eyes and you kiss my face one final time. It is the ability to stay with me until the machines stop and the ventilator ceases to pump air into my lungs and I speak one last time or squeeze your hand. If you ever have to fight a real storm, you will need a lover, but not the kind you might normally seek. This is a lover of the day and not just the night. Lovers that deal with the day are far more difficult to find. Jesus is the lover of my soul, and under his tutelage, teach us how to love.
When I found you, I found somebody who cares. When I found you, found my most intimate prayer. When I found you, I found what every heart dreams of. When I found you, I found love. When I found you, I found the rest of my I found you, I found love.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. You're welcome to Help Us of Your Joy, the best relationship and my counseling program on radio. And this is Sweet Melodies 94.3 FM. You can reach us on the following social media apps as well: Facebook, Sweet Melodies 94.3 FM, Twitter at Sweet Melodies FM. Instagram, Sweet Melodies 94.3 FM, YouTube, Sweet Melodies, and the tuning app, Sweet Melodies FM. Call your friend, call your husband, call your wife, call your beloved, call your church members, call your colleagues in the office and tell them that they help us alive on air tonight. And tonight we're going to spend some more time discussing the subject of communication in marriage. But before we proceed, I want to read some little article to all of us. Says that after more than 40 years as a counselor, I've learned to ask couples, what do you like about the way your spouse communicates? One man explained that he needs to hear continual affirmation that he's a good father and husband, even if he doesn't quite measure up to all of his wife's desires and expectations. He wants to be given physical affection and assurance that she's glad she married him. Sometimes he even worries about that issue. A wife told me that she appreciates that her husband listens without trying to fix things and supports her in pursuits that make her a better person and draw her closer to God. She said he frequently encourages her and carefully chooses his words. What do these comments have in common? Both people express their need for encouragement. We have the power to build a healthy marriage by offering our spouse encouragement rather than criticism. This form of positive communication involves some basic habits: being intentionally gentle, listening intently, and validating our spouse. Through encouragement, we can bring about change, growth, and the fulfillment of potential. We awaken the feeling, someone believes in me. You may think of encouragement as praise and reinforcement, but it's more than that. Praise is limited. It's a verbal reward. Praise emphasizes competition. It has to be earned, and it's often given for being the best. Encouragement is given freely. It can involve noticing something in a person that others take for granted, or affirming something that others notice but never think of mentioning. Encouraging your spouse through positive communication can change his or her entire approach to life. Encouraging your spouse through positive communication can change his or her entire approach to life. Interesting article. There's more to it, but We'll just take it bit by bit, and it's just giving us a summary of all that we've been talking about in the area of communication. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 15 says, "But speaking the truth in love, that you may grow up in him, in all things, who is Christ, even the head." Let me just read it properly so that I don't misquote. It says in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 15, "But speaking the truth in love may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ." But speaking the truth in love may grow up into him in all things, which is the head, even Christ. And so we've been talking about the various facets of communication, how we should speak. There must be some communication all the time. We must speak the truth, and then speak the truth in love. Last time we were on air, we also talked about the things we should avoid when we are communicating with one another. Tonight, we will spend the time talking about the other ways of communication in our marriages, other ways that we can communicate in our marriages. And tonight with me in the studio is Reverend Eddie Adeyama. Reverend Eddie, you are very welcome.
Thank you, Reverend Alex.
Fantastic. So, you heard what I just read. What we're reading, whilst we started, talked about how positive communication encourages your spouse and can change his or her entire approach to life. And so tonight, we want to spend some time talking about the positive aspects of our communication in the house, what we can do or say, other forms of sending messages across to our spouses, to our beloveds, to our husbands or wives that will encourage them or make them feel loved, that can change their entire approach to the way they see things. You know, sometimes the marital life can be burdensome. It can be tiring. Maybe the man, as a husband, is breaking his back to earn all the money to take care of the home. The wife is also breaking her back to raise their children or to take care of the babies, and combining that with work as well. And both of us deprive each other of the opportunity to be as sweet as possible. And so we want to just learn these things, learn these qualities and this principles on how to be encouraging to one another by communicating in other ways apart from just speaking. Let's welcome our other counselors who have also joined us in the studio tonight. Let's start with Reverend Ben Jones. Reverend Ben Jones, you're welcome.
Thank you very much.
Well, all the listeners, as you say to you, they miss you.
The feeling is mutual.
Fantastic. So, listeners, Reverend Ben Johnson misses you as well. And then we have with us as well Pastor Godfrey Osebuachi. Pastor Godfrey, you're welcome.
Thank you very much, Reverend Alex.
Okay, I think you need to draw closer to the mic. Okay. Pastor
Thank
Godfrey.
You, Reverend Alex.
Great. Okay, we'll sort it out. Right, so we want to discuss the other ways of communicating in marriage. We're still using our model marriage manual as our foundational book. That is the book we're picking all our information from, written by Bishop Doug Heward Mills. We know that some of you have called to ask where you can find some to buy. We'll speak to the studio, the station, and make arrangements to have some at the front desk. And when you call or you send mobile money, we'll arrange for you to have a copy. It's a must-have if you're married or you're planning to get married. And so the first other way you can communicate to your husband or to your wife or to a loved one is in the giving of gifts and presents. I see Pastor Reverend Eddie nodding and smiling. Did you receive a gift from your wife?
Several times.
And the latest one, the recent one was when? It's turned into an interrogation.
That's what it's looking like. But these are not things that I can easily, even because it comes easily to her. So I would not even want to put that I'm not one of, I can't just number them. But just looking at the subject, I think it is also interesting to recap some of the things that we have said earlier.
Yes.
In the sense that when we dealing with this subject, we are saying that it's communication, which means that it deals with two people.
That's right.
Right. So there is a certain notion or a certain kind of understanding that sometimes it is always from one side to the other. And some other people must be recipient and the other must not must be the giver.
Yeah.
But it's both ways. So I am trying to make emphasis on the fact that what we are dealing with the subject or other ways of communication, where we are talking about giving of gifts, we are specifically emphasizing that it must come from both ways. It must be practiced either from the husband to the wife or the wife to the husband. And I feel that is very, very important, because when it becomes one-sided, when it becomes one way, it loses. I mean, the person who is even the giver tends to feel that he's being
manipulated.
But then the Bible
talks, he's been taken advantage
he's been
of.
Taken advantage or he's been taken for granted.
Mm.
And so, like the Bible had always said, it is always a blessing to be a giver than to be a receiver. You see, it's more blessed to be a giver than a receiver. So I am always on that side where I say that, look, be the giver. Be the giver. When you receive, you also must what? Give back.
Give back. Okay. So, Reverend Ben, your take.
Yeah. You know, I think I tend to agree that sometimes when you are the giver, you feel that at a point the devil sort of tells you that, oh, you're being taken advantage of. But I always use the scripture to encourage me anytime I get that feeling that it is more blessed to give than to receive. So if you approach the marriage, both the husband and wife approach the marriage with that small little scripture, but powerful, it's more blessed to give than to receive. you would always be looking out
for the opportunity
to be blessed in the marriage.
Mm.
And that sort of creates a garden of bliss, if I may put it that way.
Okay, so I want to move it on to Pastor Godfred and then ask that what kind of gifts are useful or nice to give between a husband and a wife? What kind of gifts would be practical enough? I remember how my wife would always buy me specific cufflinks.
Okay.
And I still have some of them. And the design and the colors are unique. I've not seen anybody wear those cufflinks. But every time she traveled, she'd bring me a pair or two cufflinks. And every time I wear them, I remember the year she traveled and she brought me that.
Thank you, Reverend. I think it is... Let me start this way. It is beautiful when couples are in the, you know, they always giving to each other. Mm. Let me say it that way. And with the question that you asked, you should be sensitive to what interests your spouse or your partner. Because what I may be interested in is not what another person also likes. I have a friend who can't wear wristwatch, no matter the cost, no matter how expensive or how beautiful it is. He cannot just wear it. He doesn't like perfumes. So you may invest in perfumes thinking that it will touch his heart, but that is not him.
Mm.
I personally like certain things, and thank God my wife knows.
So the point you're making is that in giving something to your wife or husband, you should know
what they are interested in.
Exactly.
What will excite them? Mm. What will touch their heart?
Mm.
You can't just buy anything because Lydia is buying so and so for the husband, so let me also buy some.
Or they brought morning coats to the office to sell, and you notice that your colleagues were buying morning coats.
So you buy morning coats for an Ashanti man.
It's not even the cost. I mean, one of the days my wife brought home a good soft gar kinky and fish.
Wow.
Out of the blue.
And your garnish came.
My garnish came, made my night, and the rest was
fulfilled.
For her.
The rest was given back.
You also gave in return.
In good measure, pressed down, shake it together and running over. That was it. You know, so sometimes it's just little. I mean, when we talk about giving, I think our minds go to
huge
expensive things. How much is it going to cost me? How much am I going to? Of course, yeah, there's some giving that will cost you money, but there's certain things, certain giving that it doesn't. I mean, even ordering lunch.
Yeah.
For your wife,
yeah,
you know, it's just beautiful. call a restaurant, whatever, and then get it delivered to her. And, you know, little things like little gestures like that.
Yeah.
I think communicates volumes in the relationship.
Wow. So, just before you come, Pastor Godfred, the bit that you mentioned that has to do with not necessarily the expenditure, but little things like you're talking about the kinky and the fish. Yeah. And how soft it was, and what a difference it made that night. You know, so just to correct that impression, sometimes people also feel that once you talk about gifts, it's actually, I must go and find something big.
Expensive.
Yeah. You know?
I must go to Dubai and go and buy.
Go and shop for my wife. Well, maybe you don't even have a passport. You know? That's a good friend.
Yeah, yes. And like I said, I think that Reverend Ben Johnson's wife, after studying him for a while, realize that
gun kinky work.
He likes kinky. So out of the blue, she brings kinky.
And it makes a difference.
Exactly.
Reverend Ben Johnson.
Oh, I see where Pastor Godfred is taking this situation. I mean, but anyway, kinky is like manna from
heaven. But we really need to be sensitive to what our spouses like, what interests them. It can be as cheap as granites.
Yeah.
Maybe that's what he likes.
Mm.
There are people who are so mad about Kofi Brookman.
Yeah.
And out of the blue, you bring the person Kofi Brookman. He's excited.
You know, I remember years ago, I mean, early when we got married, my mother-in-law traveled to her hometown, and when she on her way back, she bought about an alone cup full of tiger nuts and gave it to my wife. So, from Okunu.
This is deep.
You know, I was
real communication.
I was so excited because this one was coming straight from Inkoko, and the side were big sizes, fresh, had a lot of juice. You know, and I can still remember that day. I was very, very appreciative of that gift, you know. So, and like I'm saying, some of the gifts, and we've all agreed, has to be. What about the instances where you're expecting a certain type of gift? I remember a lady who celebrated her 40th and wanted a certain type of gift. Wanted a car. The husband has promised her a car. She wanted a particular type of car, but the husband bought some other car. So even though the car was delivered new, fresh, tear rubber and everything, she never appreciated the car because she didn't get the kind of gift she was expecting. How about something like that? I mean, I'm just trying to emphasize the point you're making that we should be sensitive and be sure that what we're giving to our spouses would be pleasing.
So that actually opens a certain door of let's be a little relaxed on the specificities.
Okay.
Because sometimes, just like what Pastor Godfrey was talking about, that you should know what the interest of the person is.
Mm.
Sometimes you would realize that you want to do something out of the blue.
Mm.
You want to bring variety. You want to spice it with something that may not necessarily be one of the likes
of your spouse.
Yes, but you just want to do something because it's that thing that also sparks
something
because you have gone. It's your initiative.
Mm.
It's not what she was expecting, but you want to do something for her.
Mm.
So the point here is that we must be able to appreciate whatever comes as a gesture of gift from our spouse.
Mm.
Because there are times that, like this, the husband did not buy exactly
what she wanted.
But I think the way to go about this was to just appreciate it. And that gesture of appreciation can trigger something that can, the husband can look, you know, I will change this car at another time.
Mm.
But to totally show this
the satisfaction,
I think that also is a wrong communication altogether. We transmit to our spouse.
So the key thing I'm taking from you is the fact that whichever gift it is, that sense of appreciation and gratitude.
It's the motive.
Yeah.
The motive behind, it's very important.
Mm.
The gesture,
it
must be considered because the person that taught, it's a the thought of you and the love behind it.
So let me take this around the table. What if you have to decide to surprise your wife with a gift tonight on your way home? Starting with Pastor Godfred. She's listening to you. what would you do? I mean, what would you? Because we are often accused as men of not knowing how to buy the right thing sometimes. So, Pastor Godfred, I want your wife to hear that you are bringing her a gift. What kind of gift will you bring? We are hoping she'll be sleeping.
No, I don't think she'll be sleeping, but I'm just looking at the time, almost 10 o'clock. My wife at 10 o'clock, it will be very difficult to really please her with a gift. In the sense that pizza, no. At this time, she won't take it. Let me think through.
Reverend Ben Johnson, it's your turn. No, I'm not saying now, but if you have to maybe consider a gift for your wife, as we sit around the table, we're discussing it, we want to practicalize it. That, okay, we discussed communication through giving of gifts. Is that so that people can pick ideas from us? That okay, I would consider maybe a pair of earrings with a necklace. I'll consider bangles. I'll consider some undies. I'll consider something so that people can pick ideas. Yeah. Because often people are bereft of these
not
things.
Tonight.
Not like tonight. No, actually, do something.
I think a few more gin strings will help. Would be nice. Yeah, would be well appreciated.
Wow.
Yeah. A few more because I've bought some already.
Wow.
The marking scheme be high.
He has raised the marking scheme.
I was actually thinking about tonight, if I was going and I needed to get something, I'll just pass through Frankie's, get her a cup of ice cream.
Mm.
She will like it.
She will like
it. Yeah, just the thought of bringing ice cream for her.
Yeah.
Oh, passing through, she'll be so happy.
Passing through Frankie's. Even if she doesn't eat it tonight, the fact that you bought ice cream.
I diverted my route because I would certainly have gone through Airwork.
Yeah.
But I went through Usu and got ice cream for her coming from Frankie's just because of her. She would just, she'd be so excited.
Wow.
I mean, that actually, it's like tonight I have to do that for her. Because
you have committed yourself.
I have committed myself.
Remember,
commit yourself.
You know, copying is good. I mean, it's true. I mean, like, going out of your way, getting ice cream is nice. But I was going to give myself as a gift to my wife.
Living sacrifice.
No. Yeah. But look, this type of sacrifice where there are personal benefits here.
because go home and, refresh.
It's a gift.
Freshen up, you know.
Especially if you don't bath every evening.
Yeah.
And you go and bath.
I'll bath my best perfume and then spend quality time with her.
Yeah.
Mm.
It's a gift.
It's a gift.
She knows that I've had a long day and yet come home and want to
spend some good time and offer yourself.
Offer myself.
Wow. There's nothing better. Okay, Charlie. So you see the listeners, as you can see, the varied ideas have been given. It's not just about buying something expensive, but it's also about what the act you put together. I mean, even being available is a gift. It's a gift.
You know, the Bible says in, I was looking for Proverbs, trying to get it. It says, a gift makes room.
Mm.
Yeah.
For I think Proverbs 8.
It makes room for you.
For you. You see, so and I read one in the Message Bible says a gift sort of gets your attention.
Mm.
You know, a gift will get your attention. So a gift must be something that must get the attention of the receiver.
Wow.
You see. So any, like you're saying, I mean, the ice cream definitely will get the wife's attention, you know. And so for me, that's also an angle that we can look at.
Yeah. So listeners, your WhatsApp messages, keep them coming in, 0279-100-600, 0279-100-600. I find this discussion very interesting.
Right.
And I feel that that's also one aspect of our relationship. It would bring some excitement.
Yeah.
Then we will easily get to the point where now we want to outdo each other.
Mm.
And it becomes like a game.
Mm.
You know, we're not buying expensive things, but every time I've gone out, I notice something that I feel that will look good. I surprise you with a box of handkerchiefs. You next time, you also surprise me with something. And then we keep going. And we would always have something to look forward to. You know, so it's also a way of communicating love. And in this instance, we're talking about communicating love and how much you appreciate your beloved. I have a text message from here. A WhatsApp says that, bless you, help us, please. I've known this guy for a while and it's kind of person I've been praying for God to give me, but he has not proposed and all of a sudden he has stopped chatting with me. But I want him back and to be my partner in life. Please, I want to know if it's biblical for me to pray about him, for God to bring him back into my life, and is it possible? Please help me and give me a scripture to pray about because he's really into God's business. Thank you. If we are from Madina Bochi. Reverend Eddie, what do you think?
I think that it's a good thing to take everything to God in prayer. There's nothing wrong. You should just pray about it. if the will of God has to be done concerning she and this gentleman, it will be established. Nothing will stop it.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, if it's the fact that he has stopped calling and he's not responding to your call, or that kind of relationship is not there. The Bible says that the mind of a king is in the hands of God, and he turned it whichever way he wants. So it's possible to just call on God and say that, God, draw this person's attention. If it's the will of God, that's the underlining, if it's the will of God that this person and she come together, nothing will stop it. And so I just wanted to have that peace. And let's not allow fear and anxiety. You see, sometimes we become so anxious about it so that it begins to eat us up. But like we know from what the Bible says in Philippians 4:6, the Bible says that be careful for nothing, be anxious for nothing, but in all things, with prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, we should let our request be made known unto God. If this is her heart cry, I believe that God would quickly step in and bring an answer.
Mm. Fantastic. Another WhatsApp message here says that, hello, my name is Nana. I've been married to my husband for 3 years now, but we dated for 4 years before marriage. For some time now, my husband and I don't really flow like before. Communication, I would say, is just 30%. We all leave for work, and when we get back, he hardly talks to me, but always finds delight in chatting with friends and watching movies. We hardly even get close in bed, but at times I feel all is not well, because he can chat for the whole day or sneak out to make a call and carries his phone everywhere he goes. Pastor Godfred?
I think it's an unfortunate situation, but I think the lady should just pray. You know, there is nothing that is above God. There's nothing that is impossible when we bring them before God. I don't know the genesis of things, how they related with each other, you know, when they started, I mean, when they became couples. But whatever it is, the lady too has to, you know, walk back memory lane. If there's something that she did that brought that cold attitude in the relationship, she should also try to see and then work on it in order to address this situation. Secondly, if they are both Christians, and I'm believing that they are, they need a counselor, a pastor to talk to.
Okay.
She can't handle this situation on her own. She needs to talk to a senior person in the faith for them to be counseled, and I believe that it will work out.
Fantastic. All right, let's take another we'll come back to the WhatsApp messages. Another mode of communication is touching and kissing in marriage. Kissing or kisses are often in short supply in marriages.
Very, very, very true.
In Africa.
In Africa.
Yeah.
I remember once upon a time, there was an incident where, I think it was on the anniversary of one of our pastors, and Bishop said that they should, is that they are 10th or, is it 10th or 15th anniversary, and Bishop said that they should kiss. Look, you could see that it was a real challenge. And for me, that was a sign that it was out. It's totally out in the marriage. Now, there were other things that, is it because they were standing in front of the church? Is it, that's the reason why they couldn't do it? Or the fact that the thing was not actually happening in the relationship? I believe that it's very, very, very important to be able to express this act of touching and kisses in the house. My little boy, who is about, he just turned 6 years. Anytime I come from the house and I make a mistake not to hug my wife, or I'm quickly rushing to the room. He will say, Daddy, you've not given mommy a hug today. What does that tell me? It tells me that there's something this boy is picking. He's seeing that it's a norm.
Mm.
It's a lifestyle to relate with your wife
in a certain
in
way.
A certain way. And anytime he does that, look, I would quickly have to, revert and quickly go and hug.
Before you do what you
before
have to
I
do.
Before I do whatever, no matter. Sometimes I'm just even rushing to the bathroom to, take a pee.
Mm.
But just the fact that
the little boy has noticed that you've left something out.
I've left something out. My arrival, the entrance.
So do you kiss?
Oh, regular. It's a must kiss. I mean, a very good example. Today I was rushing out of the house. Because of the rain, I had to move for work early. She was asleep. I just went to give her a kiss. That was the way I told her that I was leaving.
You were on your way out.
Then she quickly said, what's the time? I said, it's time for me to leave. I mentioned the time and I left.
Mm.
So I think it's a good thing to practice. And like I'm saying, it must be.
So sometimes instead of words.
Yes.
Instead of just words.
Words.
Talking. Maybe your other partner is even upset. Then instead of also talking back,
just a touch,
or a little peck, or a kiss, just silences the storm that is about to brew.
And
I see Pastor Godfrey has a wry smile on his face.
Yeah, you see, when it comes to touches, I mean, it is a very good communication in marriages and relationships. But I see, unfortunately, sometimes some parties don't really like to be touched, and especially I don't know, but in my case, I mean the ladies, my wife, she's not fond of too many touches. And I remember the late Major Murphy. He said, when you're touching women, I don't like that. What is that? And he says that with women, when they're doing stop it, I don't like that, is when they like it. And sincerely, I mean, anytime I don't like it, then I try again. Stop it, and it works out.
Mm.
It is a nice way of relating. Stop it, then you hit this person, and eventually there is laughter, there are smiles, intimate conversations, which leads to
other things. Begin to happen.
Exactly.
Mm.
And I think these are things that we need to work on. From where we have come from as Africans, as Ghanaians, that was not how we were brought up. But these are good things that we need to learn.
Mm.
With cases, that there are some people who I remember very well when we married in the early stages. I can't talk about that here. But it was something that my wife, tried to do, that typical, Pentecostal African boy, what is this? Then later on, I went to research and I wanted it. To date, I beg for it, I don't get it. So sometimes certain things that we do kills some things in our spouses.
Mm.
And we really need to watch them, because a time will come you won't get it.
Yeah.
We need to encourage each other when it comes to the touching, the kissing. They are good things.
Mm.
We need to learn and do them.
Well, I remember a story that Bishop shared with us about a pastor and his wife, that the pastor didn't like the husband.
Yeah.
The lady didn't like her husband touching her all the time.
The man got sick.
The man got sick with a terminal disease and now couldn't lift the hand to. And when he died, She longed
for the touches,
so it's also another important way of expressing how we feel about each other.
A very powerful way. I mean, sometimes like the lady's text message she sends, that the husband doesn't communicate. You may not be in the mood to communicate verbally.
Yeah.
Mm.
So that is where the touching and the kissing sends a reassuring message
of love,
that all is well.
Yeah.
I'm just tired. Yeah. So putting my hands on your tie or just touching you.
Vital points.
Yeah, just holding you, holding. Sometimes, I mean, lying in bed, maybe reading or doing something, you know, answering to a call, and we hold hands.
Yeah.
You know, she's probably also doing something on her phone, or, you know, we don't use, so that communicate, the touching.
Exactly. The body contact
yeah. establishes the fact that all is well.
Yeah.
You know, the fact that we are not talking doesn't mean, you know.
And I acknowledge that you are there.
Yeah. You know, but maybe I'm watching football. So sometimes when I'm watching football, I intentionally, you know, just touch her so that, you know, I'm still here. You know? So I think that mode of communication comes to sort of filling the gap when, you know, you can't always be talking.
Yeah, you can't always be talking. That's the point. Yeah. Fantastic. Yeah,
I think, just like we are saying, we should also try so hard that we don't use touches always at the time when we want to have sex.
Okay.
We should become a practice where, like Reverend Ben is saying, it's just being in bed reading or doing something, we are holding hands. It's a sign of communication that we are together.
Yeah.
You know, but for most men, they only will touch because they are touching with an agenda.
Yeah.
And I think that is wrong.
Okay.
Something happened recently where my attention was drawn to an incident where a lady was going through moments of sadness and some worries.
Yeah.
And all she needed was that touch to show that I'm with you. And
she didn't get it
and what became an issue. So I think that we must express this as a way of communicating to say that I'm with you.
Yeah.
I'm for you.
I'm there for together. You. I did for you
like never before.
Wow. But you see, the point you made about the fact that we men usually will touch because we're looking forward to something. So, I mean, what are the ways? Your wife is in the kitchen cooking and you get to the fridge to get a drink. Yes, you don't stand with her to help her cook. But just touching, rubbing her back or something is a way of communicating something, oh?
Yeah. You know, and I think that the melancholic people must come out of their melancholy. Mm. Because these, like kissing and touch, sometimes linked to temperaments.
Okay.
Know, where, you know, one temperament, you know, sort of...
A bit too reserved and stiff.
Yeah. Be Holy Spirit controlled, you know, so that you can also flow in that. Because it doesn't come naturally to people, but that's what we need to learn.
Yeah,
you know, it may not come naturally to you.
But it doesn't come naturally to all of us, especially in this part of the world.
Yeah.
So the point you're making is very important. Our temperament, and then also a certain
culture shouldn't get in the way. You know, you can overcome it and learn.
No, it is said that when you see a guy walking with a lady and they are holding hands, it's likely they are not married.
Yeah,
which is it's a message that I resent because it's something from the pit of hell.
Yeah,
you know, why? You know, so those are the things.
Mm.
The other thing, just to add to what we are saying, the other thing I think it also must be a thing we must emphasize is that. As married couples, we should try and in our casual, let me use the word, casual touches, with our casual touches, we must go beyond just touching the places that everybody can easily touch. Do you understand? Because somebody will touch your wife and greet her at work. But you have a certain authority to touch some places. So take advantage of who you are to touch some places to show that,
the body belongs to you.
Yeah, it belongs to you.
Because the Bible says, your wife's body, I mean.
No, it's a very important because, you see, you can go through work. There's nothing wrong with.
So what you're saying is that you are barring handshakes.
I mean, handshakes are normal. It's so normal that a colleague will just give you a handshake.
For the non-owners.
Yeah. But for the owners.
Go into the engines. Uh-huh. Touch. Be able to press the butt. You know, be able to. You know, like you pass through the kitchen, she's cooking quickly. you squeeze a little, and then you move on. It's a good sign. Are you understanding what I'm saying?
I'm a good student, so I understand.
It's a good sign. Don't just go and, there are places to touch, you know, to make a statement.
Many years ago, my grandfather told me that when a car doesn't belong to you, never open the engine of the car.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow.
A car that doesn't belong to you,
don't open the engine.
Don't open the engine. Fidgeting with the engine.
There are parts that you can't.
The car doesn't belong to you.
It doesn't belong to you.
If it belongs to you, you open the engine, you check the engine oil. But if it doesn't belong to you,
you don't know even where to check.
You don't even know
where to check. You just sit in it. They'll give you a lift and then they drop you. Don't go into the engine.
So, your grandfather, which car was he referring to?
Remember, Alex. I mean, we are laughing and we are talking on this subject, but I think it's a very, very important part. Because, you see, for women, touches means a lot to them.
Yeah.
It means, for men, it's what we see. Wow. As we see, it excites us. But for the woman, the kind of touch and the area you touch draws a lot of current and sends a lot of signals. And drops in message. They come into their thoughts one after the other. So you must touch the person at the place where the statement will be clear.
Pastor Godfrey.
Yeah, I like this topic on touching. But I think that one other thing, Reverend Eddie said something earlier.
Yes.
About the fact that for men, you know, the women think that when we begin touching,
there's an agenda.
We have an agenda. And I think it's something that we need to work on. You see, unfortunately, that is how women think. And it's because
of how we've done things.
We have done things over the
period
like that. I think that to, you know, to diffuse that erroneous impression, that at times as men, we need to suppress our feelings so that your touching doesn't end where your feelings
doesn't always you.
Exactly.
Okay.
You know, otherwise, I mean, I don't know, but I hear it. We touch it, hey, what are you driving at?
So is it not because sometimes the response to the touch or the attempt to kiss is also negative? Because like you're saying, our wives feel that, okay, you're touching with an agenda or you're kissing with an agenda. So they are resisting it. So with time, we also begin to lose interest in it, and we don't want to carry on in that direction.
Yeah, you have a point. And that is one thing that the women should also be careful about, because it can also get there.
Okay.
And at a point that they also want more of those, the man is not forthcoming because you've killed it.
Keep your messages coming in. We have quite a few here. Let me try and read a few of them. He says, "Hello, helpers. Kudos for the good work. Everyone likes to receive gifts, but sometimes when priorities are not set right, it makes the gift not appreciated. For example, when your husband is not paying the school fees and bills are piling up and he buys you an iPad, for Christ's sake, I'll sell the iPad to pay the fees."
I agree.
Thank you. Amma from Lagos.
I agree
perfectly.
100%.
I'm not paying bills. I'm buying an iPad.
Amma, you're the counselors. You have the support of the counselors. 100%. So, good evening, helpers. You have made my night. Tonight's discussion is superb and fantastic. God bless you all. George Mensah from Abokobi. George, God bless you. Keep listening. We have another one here. It says, "Hello, helpers. I'm enjoying the program. Please, can you give us a sample of gifts to communicate with? Thank you." I think we gave quite a few.
Oh, yes.
Somebody said he would buy G-strings. Somebody said he would give himself.
Yeah, himself.
Another person said he would buy ice cream.
Ice cream.
So these are examples. Some could buy earrings.
Some buy kinky.
Some buy kinky and fish at unexpected times.
Unexpected times.
I mean,
attire and things.
The subject of touching, Reverend Alex. You see, I think that we must be able to. differentiate the touches. I'm taking it to another level.
Yes, go ahead.
Because you see, there are times that you are needed to touch, especially in the area of foreplay. You are needed to touch. At that time, most men,
they don't touch.
They don't touch. They are so much in a hurry to perform, to fire. And so they are touching mannerism. it's very weak.
Revenedy, you're taking it to another level, like you said. we are saying that touching as a means of communication.
That's what I'm talking about, not communicating.
As steps to...
Because, you see, I'm talking about communicating because it's the way you communicate in that direction, that is how you'll be also be able to receive a very good love making.
Okay.
If you don't communicate it well, when they need it most, and you don't give it, it does not stir up those things that would make them perform.
You know, we have to come back to this subject and discuss it again. I think that the long and short of it is that we have to learn to be better touches, if there's a word like that, and better kisses. I mean, like we said earlier, in marriages, kissing and touching sometimes runs is in short supply. It doesn't happen as much as it should. And so we've run out of time. We have to draw down the curtains on tonight's program. But it's been interesting, and I believe that we need to come back to discuss this subject again. There are different forms of communication in marriage. I mean, other forms, apart from words, what other things can we do? We've talked about the gifts. We've talked about touching and kissing. We have to develop it and talk about it some more so that we can spice up our relationships, and what we can, so that at least there's some sweet atmosphere. Everybody likes a gift. A gift tells you that you are appreciated and you are loved. If somebody touches you in a tender manner, why not? And so, listeners, unfortunately, we've run out of time. We cannot take any calls. We had some technical challenges. We couldn't take any calls. But we believe that the next time we're on air, we'll be able to open the phone lines and we'll get you to call in and tell us about your experiences with regards to giving of gifts, presents, touching, and kissing. But before we leave, I want to give you an opportunity to give your life to Jesus Christ. You've been listening to the program on this station, but you're not born again. Kindly pray this prayer with us. Say, Lord Jesus.
Lord Jesus.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That for a sinner like me.
That for a sinner like me.
You came to die.
You came to die.
Jesus.
Jesus.
Tonight.
Tonight.
I confess. That I'm a sinner.
I'm a sinner.
Come into my heart.
Come into my heart.
Forgive me of all my sins.
Forgive me of all my sins.
Wash me. And make me a new person.
Make me a new person.
From today I'll follow you.
From today I'll follow you.
And I'll serve you. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus.
For accepting me. Just the way I am.
Amen.
So God bless you for praying this prayer. If it's your first time of praying a prayer, we would like to hear from you. And if you also have any questions or comments to make to us, kindly call us on 054-351-4400. 054-351-4400. But I must say that tonight has been very interesting. We would continue the same subject the next time we're on air. So this has been Helpers of Your Joy on Sweet Melodies 94.3 FM, and I want to say a big thank you to our anointed and interesting counselors, Reverend Adeyemi. Thank you so much for coming.
God bless you. It's always a privilege and an honor to be here.
And Reverend Ben Johnson, thank you for coming. Yes, thank you so much. It's a blessing having you. And Pastor Godfred, thank you so much for coming.
It's been a blessing.
Wow. So listeners, thank you so much for listening and tuning in. Keep listening to Sweet Melodies 94.3 FM. And we want to say God bless you. Keep listening. Have a good night. My name is Reverend Alex Otuankama. God bless you. Have a good night. Bye-bye.